Well, thank you for joining us. Welcome to Grace. As we move along in our journey through the Bible, we're going to continue to see that great lesson that God's been teaching his human creation through his word thus far. Actually, he's been teaching this since the inception of man in the Garden of Eden. That lesson is about the gracious capacity of God that's resident within his name, who he is. His name is what it's all about, who God is and who he must be on behalf of man. That's what he's teaching us here. As God teaches us about his ability and about his capacity and his great desire to put all that he is into operation for man and do so graciously, at the same time, he's teaching us the great lesson of our incapacity, mankind's inability, and the inability of fleshly creation, we should say, given the sin nature that all have inherited and will inherit from Adam as long as we're alive on this planet and before we're caught up to be out of here. We're going to be seeing these two issues presented over and over again as we work our way through the Bible. If we're to wrap these two concepts up in a two-phrase package, we could call it, number one, the great capacity and grace of God. We're going to see that throughout the Bible as we keep moving forward. We're also going to see the opposite end of the spectrum, and that would be the continuing failure, the incapacity of sinful and prideful man. So there we have the two things we're going to see jump out at us all the way through our journey through the Bible. Were Adam and Eve, think back with me, were Adam and Eve successful at thwarting Satan's subversive tactics there and usurping the glory of God in the Garden of Eden? Sure they were. The answer is, they were not successful. The answer is no, they were unsuccessful. We followed that story early on. Eve was no match for Satan. Come to find out, Adam was no match for Eve, when the alternative was obedience to God. As disheartening as it was for us to watch Adam deliberately undermine his creator, the Most High God, the one who had formed him from the dust of the ground in the first place, God continued to put his name into action on behalf of his human creation, Adam and Eve. And he did so graciously. He supplied the sacrifice. He slew it. He clothed them with the skins of the sacrifice. But consider it for a moment. From Satan's vantage point, looking at it through the eyes of the adversary, Satan knew that he had been successful in playing a huge subversive role with Adam and Eve, at least as far as Adam and Eve having the dominion over the earthly realm that God had given them. He knew he had gained a success there. And even though God had made gracious provision for his human creation, fallen creation — I don't like to think fallen, I like to think rebellion, rebellious creation — Satan knew that neither of the progenitors of the human race were ever permitted a re-entrance to the garden planet East Garden of Eden. So from Satan's vantage point, he had scored a goal, so to speak. So as far as God's repossession of the earthly realm was concerned and his utilization of man in that repossession plan, Satan perceived, I believe, a tremendous sense of victory after Adam's rebellion. From Satan's standpoint, his coup d'etat had worked, and he held the upper hand when it came to God being able to utilize his creation called man in his earthly repossession plan. What I do not want you to lose sight of, so keep this ever in mind as we work our way through, and keep it in mind at this early point in our journey through the Bible, and we'll keep it in mind as we continue forward, is the reason why God allowed Satan this seeming initial victory when it came to God's human creation. We need to understand that God could have taken Satan out before the serpent ever had the opportunity to beguile Eve there in the garden. Could God not have simply refused to permit that encounter? Well, certainly he could have done that. Could God not have bound the rebellious cherub there before Eve was fashioned from Adam's side? He certainly could have done that as well. He could have done both, but God didn't do that. Instead, he allowed Satan to continue his subversive ways, and he allowed man to continue making decisions for themselves. The question is why? Well, the reason is really twofold. First, God would not go against his established institution called volition, because that would be contrary to the attribute of God called love, an attribute resident within God's name. God is love, according to the written word of God. Secondly, through volition, God could teach his human creation that all-important lesson that we just mentioned a minute ago, the lesson about who God is and about who man is not, the lesson about man's great need of God in light of the fact that man is a creature, a fallen creature at that, and that God alone is the creator, and that his capacity could always be relied upon by ever needful man. So those two lessons are being taught. From Adam onward, mankind has suffered the consequences of the sin nature inherited from forefather Adam. We see it around us all the time. On the one hand, mankind's failure is being highlighted as God's word points it out to us over and over again. On the other hand, God's capacity and his grace will be held up to us over and over again as we continue working our way through his word. Never forget, it's about God's abundant capacity and grace toward man, and man's incessant failure and need of God's capacity and grace to be exercised on their behalf. All right, we watched that lesson when it came to Adam and Eve and the offspring that came forth from Adam and Eve's union. The subsequent nations the Bible refers to as the Gentiles. Rather than proclaim God's name and cast themselves upon their creator, what did the Gentiles do? Well, you folks remember, I'm sure. They set out to make themselves a name through a building project called the Tower of Babel, otherwise known as the Tower of Babylon. The rebellious heart that stems from man's sin nature is continually being set before us, and we're going to see it over and over again, and proving the ongoing failure of mankind to measure up to the glory that belongs only to God. We're going to see it, as we said, time and time again, as we progress through God's lesson book about who he is, in light of the lesson we should all be learning by this time about who man is not. Again, the Bible narrative never ceases of being about the capacity resident within God's name and man's need for God to put that capacity to work on his behalf graciously. Due to our incapacity, the incapacity of a fleshly oriented humanity, we might say. All right, Adam failed. The nations or Gentiles following Adam came from Adam and Eve, failed just as miserably. As their hearts were inclined towards self rather than toward the Most High God. Elevation of self. The sin nature disease inherited from Adam manifested itself in the shortcomings of the members of Adam's lineage, as seen in the Gentile building project that was underway there in Babylon, and God's subsequent confusion of the common language being spoken in that day, whatever it was. I know the rabbinic crowd would like to think it was Hebrew. But it wasn't Hebrew. Whatever it was, God confounded that language into all the other languages, and they've changed and digressed through time, as some here could tell you. That brought us to a new channel that God would use for the proclamation of his name, and the fifth beginning of the book of Genesis, the beginning of the nation Israel. God would choose one man out from among the nations in order to establish a previously not existent nation, singular. The nation Israel. That man's name was actually pronounced correctly, Abram. Looks like Abram, and we'll just say Abram so it won't be confusing. God's plan to repossess the earthly realm would be vested in this new nation and in a king and in a kingdom directly related to this nation to be formed through the calling out of that man named Abram. This was the fifth beginning we found in Genesis as we entered chapter 12 in our journey through the Bible. We should expect to see, if what we've been saying is correct, we should expect to see the sin nature that began in the Garden of Eden operating in Abram, should we not? Because that's being held up to us over and over again. And we should also expect to see the necessity for God to do for Abram what Abram would never have the capacity to do for himself, given his humanness, for sake of a better way to express it. Who was Abram? We want to spend some time here because Abram is one of the more prominent figures in God's Word, and we'll be encountering no more prominent man except for our apostle in our journey through the Bible, apart from the God-man, Jesus Christ. And apart from the proper foundation we gain in the book of Genesis, the remainder of the Bible will make very little sense. It'll just be reading for the sake of reading without really understanding anything. Now, I'll give you just a bit of family history so that you'll have a better picture of what was going on prior to the calling of this man named Abram. Abram was the son of a man named Terach. Terach. Now, we'll pronounce it Terah, as that's how it appears in our King James translation. Terah had three sons. He had Abram, he had Nahor, and he had Haran. He also had a daughter named Sarai. You can see it on the overhead screen there. So we have three brothers and we have a sister mentioned as Terah's direct offspring. And they all lived in Ur of the Chaldees, along with their father Terah. While in Ur, two of those brothers, Abram and Nahor, decided they were going to take wives. So Abram married Sarai, a familiar name to most of us here. And Nahor, Abram's brother, married their brother Haran's daughter Milcah. The Bible tells us the identity of Sarai's parentage, at least on her father's side. Now listen to Abram give further details of Sarai's identity in Genesis chapter 20, verse 12. And yet indeed she is my, what? Sister. How so, Abram? She is the daughter of my father, but not the daughter of my mother. And she became my wife. Now this shows us how Abel and Seth, nearly 2,000 years prior to Abram's day, were able to get their wives. Man lived a whole lot longer in Adam's day, and the only way for the human race to propagate was through marriage to a sibling or to the offspring of a sibling. Brothers had to marry sisters. I know some of our young people say, yuck. But brothers had to marry sisters. The only choice they had was a sibling if they were going to marry. Then those of the following generation had a little additional choice. They had the choice between siblings and cousins. After that generation, the choice would have been between siblings and cousins and first cousins. And on it would go as the family lines began to expand. Are we not all related to Adam, really, in a general sense? Sure we are. We all go back to those common ancestors, Adam and Eve. I think you can see how the length of the average lifespan during Bible times made for a larger and larger selection when it came to a spouse as time marched along. What happened to change interfamily marriages? Why did that come to a halt? Why did interfamily marriage not continue as the norm right on through today? One obvious reason is that the sin-cursed world caused genetic mutations to occur down through time. And thus the likelihood that close relatives might carry the same genetic mutations and then pass those mutations on down to their offspring. As time progressed, the more distant the marriage relationship became family-wise, the less likely it would be for both marriage partners to carry the same genetic mutation. At least this is how creation scientists reason it. If Adam and Eve are the progenitors of the entire human race, and we know they are, we're all related. And it's an interfamily, as far as Adam and Eve are concerned, relationship. Well, in the earliest times, marriages had to begin with brothers marrying sisters, as I said, and inter-family unions that we've been talking about. By the time we come to the law of Moses, though, something else happens. We know that by that time, the human gene pool had expanded to the point that God altered what had been the accepted norm for spouse selection up to that time. With the law of Moses, inter-family marriages were strictly forbidden. Here are just a few of the restrictions God placed on marrying a close relative. You can read more about them in the book of Leviticus, but we'll put a couple up here. In Leviticus 18 through 20 is where they occur. In direct connection to the law program that would be established through Moses. Let's take a look. Leviticus chapter 18, verse 9. The nakedness of thy sister, the daughter of thy father or daughter of thy mother, whether she be born at home or born abroad, even their nakedness thou shalt thou not uncover. Abram and Nahor would have been lawbreakers had the law of Moses been in effect when they chose their wives. Now, this is a great example, folks, of how God never changes in who he is, in his name and the attributes that comprise who he is, but how he did indeed change when it came to the way that he worked with man down through the course of time. The restrictions continue, Leviticus 18, verse 10. The nakedness of thy son's daughter or of thy daughter's daughter, even their nakedness shalt thou not uncover, for theirs is thine own nakedness. So we have the family relationship being highlighted in these new restrictions here. Leviticus 18:11, the nakedness of thy father's wife's daughter. Now, that would have directly applied to Abram, would it not? The nakedness of thy father's wife's daughter, begotten of thy father, she is thy sister. Thou shalt not uncover her nakedness. Of course, it was different, as we said, in Abram's day. We've just noted that. Abram told us that. Abram would later identify Sarai to King Abimelech as his sister. Keep in mind, once again, it wasn't taboo to marry a sister prior to the law of Moses. You wouldn't have a mate early on if you did not done that. But Abram wasn't being completely honest with King Abimelech. In an attempt to deceive the king, Abram failed to tell King Abimelech that his half-sister, as we would call her today, was also his wife. Abram was afraid that in order to justify taking Sarai for himself, King Abimelech might have him killed, because we're told that Sarai was a beautiful woman. Sarai was so beautiful, and she hadn't escaped the king's attention. He had noticed her right off. So Abram didn't tell the whole truth and nothing but the truth when it came to Sarai, for fear that King Abimelech would have him killed and in order to take Sarai for his own. He simply said, "She is my sister." And King Abimelech, armed with nothing more than that information, did indeed send for Sarai, and he took her for himself. Of course, God had changed her name to Sarah by that time, but that had no bearing on Abram's deception. Here again, God was proving to all, through these stories, to all who would later read these accounts, the weakness associated with humankind's Adamic nature and man's continuing failure to come short of the right thing to do. Abram came clean only when he had to come clean with King Abimelech. He later explained to the king that Sarai was the daughter of his father Terah, but not the daughter of his mother, as we just read. That would have made Sarai Abram's half-sister, according to the designation we would give that relationship in our day. Interestingly enough, God didn't put half in front of sister, and neither did Abram. She is my sister. Leviticus 18:9 said, "The nakedness of thy sisters, whether it be the daughter of thy father or the daughter of thy mother, whether born at home or born abroad, thou shalt not uncover." So Abram would have been in deep trouble had this taken place prior to the establishment of the law of Moses. But again, sister-brother relationships were not taboo in Abram's day. That would have been just fine. It was the deception, not the family connection, that proved Abram had inherited the same sin nature all humankind inherits from forefather Adam. Abram's shortcoming is simply pointed out to us as God inspired that shortcoming to be recorded in the annals of Scripture for all eternity, to prove that men always come short from Adam and Eve through the Gentile nations all the way up here to the calling of Abram. God didn't cause those shortcomings to take place, but he knew that they would be taking place all along because he knew all about the sin nature man would inherit from Adam. As you can see with Abram's family, Abram married his half-sister Sarai. His brother Nahor married the third brother, Haran's daughter Milcah. So I think you can see why Lot, another offspring of Haran, the third brother, why Lot went along with his father, and he joined his father Terah and his uncles Abram and Nahor as they journeyed to Haran. Haran died, but the other two brothers were alive. Lot's uncle Nahor was married to Lot's sister. By the way, Sarai, Abram's wife, just as a point of interest here, was 10 years younger than her husband, Abram. Sarai died at the age of 127, the only woman in Hebrew scripture whose age is given. She died at the age of 127. Fascinating. So God's plan for Abram had begun when Abram was instructed to depart his father's house to go to a land that God would show him. This took place in Ur. Some think that Terah, his father, simply coordinated the trip because the Bible account tells us that Terah is the one who took the family to Canaan. What caused them to stop along the way and not to go into Canaan? They stopped in a city of Charan. Now it's the same spelling, H-A-R-A-N. So we have to be able to distinguish, be careful to distinguish between the man named Haran, and the city named Charan, which has the same spelling. It's not the same person, but it's a city here, even though it's spelled the same way in our King James translation. What is known is that the family settled in Haran for a time, and Abram's father Terah died there in Haran. You can see it, I think, at the top pretty evident there at the top of the illustration. Abram was now ready to depart Haran according to God's prior instructions. Let's look at the passage, Genesis 12:4. So Abram departed as the Lord had spoken unto him earlier, apparently much earlier from the location of Ur, and Lot went with him. His nephew goes along. And Abram was 75 years old when he departed out of Haran. Verse 5, and Abram took Sarai his wife and Lot his brother's son, and all their substance that they had gathered, and the souls that they had gotten in Haran, and they went forth to go into the land of Canaan. I like how the Bible puts it here. And into the land of Canaan they came. Almost sounds like a fairy tale, but this is truth here. And into the land of Canaan they came. And they lived happily ever after. Well, not really. Abram, if you notice there on our map, had already walked the eastern side of the territory of Eden just to get to Haran. And now he's walked a good portion of the western side in order to get to the land of Canaan. Verses 6 and 7 add a degree of intrigue to the story. In fact, this part is actually more important than the Abram-Sarai brother-sister relationship part of the story. Notice verse 6. And Abram passed through the land into the place of Shechem. Now, it looks like Sikkim. But Shechem, under the plain of Moreh. Moreh, and the Canaanite was then in the land. Did you catch the significance of the final portion of verse 6? Now, wait a minute. You mean to say that the Canaanite had already been occupying the land of Canaan when Abram arrived there? Well, of course they had. That's why it's called the land of Canaan. In our old quartet days, we were used to sing a song about Canaan land is all just in sight. Not to us, but that shows you the mixture of what's going on in the Bible in a lot of folks' minds. Verse 7 of Genesis 12. And the Lord appeared unto Abram and said, unto thy seed will I give this land. And there builded he, Abram, an altar unto the Lord who appeared unto him. Now the Canaanite people were already in the land, and God was giving it to Abram and to Abram's seed. When the Canaanite people were already there, does that seem fair? Does that seem just? Well, there's a lot of fighting going on about that issue today, is there not? It was totally fair. And it was the perfectly right thing to do when we look at the considerations behind that gift. First of all, who were the Canaanites? For the answer to that, we have to go back a quarter of a century to the time of the Great Flood. So let's go back there for a moment. After the flood, the earth was populated by the ancestors of Noah's sons, Shem, Ham, and Japheth. Which son had been placed, or I should say, which offspring of a son had been placed under God's curse? That was the child of Ham. Ham was the father of Cush, Mizraim, Put, and Canaan. But it was Canaan that was under God's curse. Since Ham was under, or not Ham, but Ham's offspring, Canaan was under God's curse, guess who wanted to make use of Ham's offspring? Canaan. Certainly, Satan. Satan wouldn't miss that opportunity in his plan of evil against the Most High God for a moment. Satan would jump on that opportunity as quickly as he could. From Cush came the Babylonians and the Assyrians. From Mizraim came the Egyptians and the Philistines. And from Canaan naturally came all the Canaanite clans, all the ites that you read about in Scripture. The Hittites, Jebusites, the Amorites, the Girgashites, the Hivites, the Arkites, the Sinites, the Arvadites, the Zemarites, the Hamathites. Every ite but termite is on that list. And where did they come from? Well, they came from that son of Ham named Canaan. And the Bible said, let Canaan be cursed when Ham came short of the right thing to do there with his father in the tent. The descendant structure of Ham's detailed for us in Genesis chapter 10, by the way. You can see what was happening here, I think. Ham's descendants claimed ownership over the land of Canaan and beyond because they had settled there. It had been their land as they reasoned it. But who owned that land in the first place? Let's return to the passage we noted as we entered our journey through the Bible series, 1 Chronicles chapter 29, verse 11. Thine, O Lord, is the greatness and the power and the glory and the victory and the majesty, for all that is in the heavens and in the earth is thine, belongs to you. Thine is the kingdom, O Lord, and thou art exalted as head above all. Melchizedek, by the way, the priest of the Most High God, that's an interesting story, and we can go into that a little bit down the road maybe, but Melchizedek, a priest of the Most High God, was simply stating a truth. In Genesis chapter 14, as verse 19 of that chapter states, and he, Melchizedek, blessed Abram and said, blessed be Abram of the Most High God. Now notice it. Next word. Possessor of heaven and earth. The word translated possessor means owner, rightful occupier. The psalmist could not have been more correct when he wrote in Psalms 89:11, the heavens are thine, the earth also belongs to you. As for the world and the fullness thereof, thou, speaking of the Most High God, hast founded them. So the writer of the letter of Hebrews put it this way in Hebrews 1:10. Thou, Lord, in the beginning hast laid the foundation of the earth, and the heavens are the works of thine hands. So the creator of heaven and earth had a legitimate right to give that land to Abram and to Abram's seed, because the entire earth belonged to God from the time he spoke it into existence. As we saw earlier on, the territory of Eden had been his home base prior to Lucifer's rebellion. That territory is described in Scripture as being God's house. We'll see that a little later on. It was Satan who had usurped that territory in the first place. God was simply reclaiming what rightfully belonged to him from the time that he spoke those realms into existence. You see how the battle over the earthly realm was being waged between God and Satan? The battle that had begun with Lucifer's usurpation, his rebellion in the territory of Eden, was now being waged with Lucifer's recruits as Ham's territory, or as Ham's descendants, began staking their claim to what rightfully belonged to the Creator. God owned the land. He had always owned the land. He owned the entire earth because, again, he's the one that created it. Therefore, God had the right to decide what he wanted to do with it. And he was giving to Abram and to Abram's seed that land as an everlasting possession. In spite of the fact that Satan had usurped that territory, as the descendants of Ham through Canaan's line were already occupying it. Now let's jump ahead to Genesis chapter 13 for a moment, verses 14 through 18, as we continue to work our way through the book of Genesis. As I said, we'll spend more time here than any other books, because this foundation is crucial if we're to understand what's happening in the Bible. Genesis 13, verses 14 and 15. And the Lord said unto Abram, after that Lot was separated from Abraham and Lot had an altercation, lift up thine eyes, Abram, and look from the place where thou art northward and southward and eastward and westward. For all the land which thou seest, to thee will I give it, and to thy seed for how long? Forever. Now watch once again what God has Abram do. We looked at this earlier in verse 17. Arise, Abram, walk through the land in the length of it and in the breadth of it, for I will give it unto thee. Then Abram removed his tent, came and dwelt in the plain of Mamre, which is in Hebron, and built there an altar unto the Lord. Satan had been marking off that territory through Canaan's clan. God was now telling Abram to go and mark off that same territory. Check out the boundaries, Abram. Check the boundaries out of this land. Walk the length of it and the breadth of it, because the land now belongs to you. Do you see how God was sending Satan his eviction notice right then? You think Satan was interested in relinquishing ownership of that land? You know the answer to that, I'm sure. Satan had established what might be called the hotbed for the propagation of his course for this world right there in that territory. The land of Canaan was crucial in Satan's occupation plan. Can you see how God was playing offense at this point in time? He was taking his plan to repossess his land right to the heart of Satan's occupying forces, all the ites we just mentioned. He was taking the battle for the earth right to the place where Satan's dominion over the earth was being developed and defined. If you want to see something interesting, read through Ezekiel's passage where he describes the abominations of Jerusalem sometime. We'll look at one verse here. And from where that wickedness had come in the first place. Let's quickly just visit that one passage. Here it is in Ezekiel 16, verses 2 and 3, two verses. Son of man, Ezekiel said in verse 2, or was told in verse 2, caused Jerusalem to know her abominations. Caused Jerusalem, now you know where that is, to know her abominations. The issue is not just what those abominations are, but from where those abominations had come. Notice verse 3. And say, thus saith the Lord God unto Jerusalem, thy birth and thy nativity is of, notice it, the land belonging to, or of, Canaan. Thy father was an Amorite, and thy mother an Hittite. Canaan's offspring were in possession of God's property. As simple as that. God was taking the battle for possession over the earthly realm directly to the land and to the city where Satan's dominion had previously been established. You see what God's telling Abraham here? In effect, he's saying, I'm going to repossess this land, Abram. It's mine. It belongs to me. It's been mine from the beginning, from the get-go of human of the creation of heavens and earth. And I'm going to take it back through you, Abram, and through your seed after you. I'm going to use a nation that comes from your loins, Abram, in my earthly repossession plan, to fulfill my plan to reclaim what is rightfully mine. That's the significance here, folks. It helps when we realize that repossession of the earthly realm is the key to understanding what's happening in the book of Genesis and the roots and development we're going to see of a nation called Israel. And understanding that will help us to understand the majority of the books of the Bible to follow that speak about that plan. Otherwise, these are just interesting stories sitting here and for Sunday school, but what do they really mean? Arise, walk through the land, Abram, in the length of it and in the breadth of it, for I will give it unto thee. Does the owner of the land now have the right to do with it whatever he wants? That used to be that way, didn't it? It used to work that way. Well, this owner has just given an eviction notice to those who were occupying his property. And at the same time, he was giving notice of new ownership to the one to whom he was giving it. The deed to this land had Abram's name on it, along with Abram's descendants and the ultimate seed that would come from Abram's lineage, the God-man to come, Jesus Christ. Their names were now recorded on that deed. God was now registering the deed. So Satan's plan had been to rule the earth from this territory, having established his own kingdom in it. The Most High God had an entirely different plan. He would be establishing his kingdom and what rightfully belonged to him. And so he's telling Abram here, set out the survey stakes, Abram. It's yours and your seed after you. Now, since God made a covenant with Abram, it only makes sense that we begin keeping track of the covenants of Scripture as we work our way through the Bible and we run across those covenants. The first time the word covenant appears in the Bible is in Genesis chapter 6, where God talks about a covenant that he was making with the man named Noah. The word covenant is a translation of the Hebrew berith, meaning a pact or a promise. Marriage is a covenant relationship. See, catch the idea. God made a covenant. He made a pact. He made a promise to Noah more than 200 years prior to his covenant with Abram. This is why Bible scholars refer to that earlier covenant as the Noahic, or Noahic. I don't know how you pronounce that word, but Ken may be able to tell you. The Noahic covenant. It actually contained two parts. And we'll note those parts before we continue on in Genesis with Abraham's covenant, with God's covenant with Abram. The first aspect of the Noahic covenant had to do with the direct preservation of Noah and his family. The second aspect of the covenant contains God's promise concerning the entire earth and all the earth inhabitants after the flood. Let's look at aspect number one of this covenant. It appears in Genesis chapter 6, verses 17 and 18. Here it is. And behold, I, even I, do bring a flood of waters upon the earth to destroy all flesh wherein is the breath of life from under the heaven, and everything that is in the earth shall die. Now that's a pretty serious promise, wouldn't you say? Now watch the next verse, verse 18. But with thee, Noah, will I establish my covenant, and thou shalt come into the ark, thou and thy sons and thy wife and thy sons' wives with thee. In effect, God was promising Noah that he would preserve him and his family by way of the ark that Noah was told to prepare. Otherwise, there would have been no need for Noah to prepare an ark in the first place, in light of that impending flood. So this first aspect of the promise God made concerned Noah and his three sons and their wives, and of course, the animals aboard the ark. But then God revealed a second aspect of that covenant that went beyond Noah and his family. This second aspect of the covenant concerns the earth itself, all the inhabitants of the earth to follow. This part of the covenant comes three chapters later in chapter 9 of Genesis, beginning with verse 8. And God spake unto Noah and to his sons with him, saying, And I establish my covenant with you, Noah, and with your seed after you. Keep reading. Now the second aspect of the covenant goes beyond Noah and his family to all the extended offspring of Noah in the years to come. Look at verse 10. And with every living creature that is with you, of all the fowl, of the cattle, and of every beast of the earth with you, from all that go out of the ark to every beast of the earth. And I will establish my covenant with you, neither shall all flesh be cut off any more by the waters of a flood, neither shall there any more be a flood to destroy the earth. And this was the entire earth. It wasn't a localized flood. It's the entire earth here. Genesis 9, 12 and 13. And God said, This is the token of the covenant which I make between me and you and every living creature that is with you for perpetual generations. I do set my bow in the cloud, and it shall be for a token of a covenant between me and the earth. So obviously, this is a reference to all the inhabitants of the earth to follow on the heels of Noah and the earth itself. A token of my covenant between me and the earth in this case. So it's obviously, I believe, a reference to all the inhabitants of the earth, but to the earth itself. It would never be flooded with water again. Now, three chapters later, we come to Genesis chapter 12, and we're 200 plus years down the road by this time from that flood and the covenant of Noah's day, and God's making another promise. But this time, he's making it with a man named Abram. Naturally, this covenant will be known as what? The Abrahamic covenant. Pretty easy, isn't it? I want our listeners to notice that as we conduct our journey through the Bible, we're actually doing what 2 Timothy 2:15 calls upon all Bible students to do. We're rightly dividing the word of truth. You know the verse. You know the passage. There it is, 2 Timothy 2:15. Study to show thyself approved unto God, a workman that needeth not to be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth. Now, we learned at the outset of our study that Abram, although not created, or not Abram, but Adam, although not created equal with his creator, because Adam was indeed corruptible and the creator is incorruptible, but Adam began his life on earth with an innocent mind. This is why many Bible scholars call the first set of house rules by which God dealt with man on earth the dispensation or economy of innocence. However, Adam took his eyes off of his creator. His corruptibility became extremely apparent as he succumbed to the suggestion of Eve, and thus began the ongoing downward trek of mankind. We called it evolution or devolution rather than evolution. God would change the channel through whom he would make his name known to the earth. Adam would not be that primary channel. With the fall of Adam, I think of it more in a sense of rebellion, as I said earlier, God began dealing with man according to knowledge, or I should say according to conscience. The Bible tells us that Adam and Eve knew that they were naked. There's conscience, given birth in the garden. And from that time forward, God began dealing with mankind according to their own sense of right and wrong as their consciences dictated that to them. The dispensation of innocence ended with Adam and Eve's expulsion from the garden. And the dispensation of conscience ended with the great flood of Noah's day. Is conscience in place today? Of course it is, but consciences can be seared. They can be programmed incorrectly and need to be reprogrammed. And so while we still have conscience, this was God dealing with men directly in accordance with their conscience. So as we continue to follow the course of human history, we learn that the Gentiles or nations coming from Adam and Eve fared no better than the first parents when their consciences were ruling the day. The result was the great flood of Noah's day, as we see taking place as that dispensation of conscience winds forward. Then we watched as God ushered in a brand new way of dealing with man, or a new set of house rules, a new dispensation called the dispensation of human government with those who disembarked the ark. Noah was told that God would never again flood the earth with water. And as a further expression of that covenant he made with Noah, listen to Genesis chapter 8, verse 22. While the earth remaineth, seed time and harvest and cold and heat, and summer and winter and day and night shall not cease. Now notice God didn't say what seed would be planted at harvest time, although planted and harvested, I should say, although the genetic engineering of our day certainly didn't escape his attention. His foreknowledge, he would have known that. Neither was he revealing the different cycles of cooling and heating that would be taking place on this planet as time went along. The earth has experienced times of cooling and to be followed by periods of heating from the time of the flood. In fact, it was the flood of Noah's day that brought about the polar ice caps in the first place. Weather patterns are cyclical. I think we should all know that. Scientists know that full well. We hear about global warming today and the great alarm being spread across the land about the destruction of the planet due to the increased carbon emissions of flatulent cows and car exhaust fumes. As though this verse in Genesis chapter 8 wasn't sitting here at all. While the earth remaineth, and it isn't going away, according to Scripture, until God destroys it in order to create new heavens and a new earth. Seed time and harvest and cold and heat and summer and winter and day and night shall not cease. The God who created it has promised. It's the arrogance of human flesh to suggest that man's going to cause to cease that which God states with no equivocation shall not cease. It's all sitting there in the covenant with Noah that God made. Here lately, we're being told the consensus, and this is interesting, in climate science is bending from norming to warming to stalling, and many are even turning toward the position of global cooling right now. So I guess milk is good for us one day, bad for us the next day, good for us the next, and extremely bad the next, and coffee and on it goes. But let's return. to the dispensation being ushered in after the dispensation of conscience. When the ark landed on Mount Ararat, God issued, or we might say dispensed, a new set of house rules, a new dispensation, a new economy called the dispensation of human government. There it is again on the screen. Why is this new economy by which God began dealing with men after the flood called the dispensation of human government? Why was it given that title? Was given that name because of the new rules that God initiated with Noah and his sons, rules that were to apply from that time forward. Here they are, sitting in four verses of Genesis chapter 19. I'll read them. Now notice the governing rules that God was passing down to Noah and to those after Noah. In this section, it begins with verse 3. Every moving thing that liveth shall be meat or food for you. That wasn't the case prior to that. Every moving thing that liveth shall be food for you. Even as the green herb have I given you all things. But flesh with the life thereof, which is the blood thereof, shall ye not eat. They had to bleed the animals. Now watch verse 6. Whoso sheddeth man's blood, by man shall his blood be shed. For in the image of God made he man. There sits right there the basis of the capital punishment being practiced in many quarters today. The institution of capital punishment presupposes governmental authority. God never removed the house rules pertaining to human government. Not yet, not till there's a theocracy in place upon this earth. The headship order of human government is still in place today, folks. This is why Paul tells the saints of the dispensation of grace to be subject unto the higher powers. For there's no power but of God, Paul tells us. The powers that be are ordained of God. How do we know that capital punishment was God's plan for the dispensation of the grace of God, that it didn't go away? Well, we can look to the Apostle Paul for that information. Here it is in Romans 13:1. Let every soul be subject unto the higher powers, for there's no power but of God. The powers or headship order that be are ordained of God. The headship order, the headship positions are ordained of God. Again, God's intention was for those filling the positions of the powers mentioned here to be selected according to their acknowledgement and adherence to the Word of God. We can see how far the human race has moved away from that idea. But let's continue with Paul. Verse 2. Whosoever therefore resisteth that power, resisteth the ordinance of God, and they that resist shall receive to themselves damnation from God. No, from those powers that are in place. Look at verse 3. For rulers are not a terror to good works, not the rulers that should be selected according to the principles of God's Word, but to the evil. Wilt thou then not be afraid of the power? Do that which is good, and thou shalt have praise of the same. Now watch, and we'll see the continuance of capital punishment, that capital punishment concept in human government, being mentioned by our apostle, the apostle of grace, the apostle Paul. Here it is in verse 4. For he is a minister of God to thee for good, but if thou do that which is evil, be afraid, for he, that ruling authority, beareth not, what? The sword in vain. The idea here is not playing sword fight. For he is the minister of God, a revenger to execute wrath upon him that doeth evil, and with a sword. Some might argue that capital punishment should be eliminated today because we do not have godly men, godly rulers, in positions of authority today. Do you suppose that all of the rulers of Rome in Paul's day were all godly rulers? I suppose not. Yet Paul's giving us these instructions here, and he's giving them to grace age believers, grace dispensation, I should say, believers. The law of the land is the law of the land. It may not end up being the law we like, but as long as that law does not require that we go contrary to the word of God, we're to adhere to the law of the land. I've been questioned by some whether or not believers should give up their guns, should the government require that of us today. After all, it's argued gun ownership is a God-given right. Is it? Show me that in the word of God. Where do we find that in the Bible? That gun ownership is a God-given right. Now, gun ownership is certainly a constitutional right for the citizenry of this country. We know that. We understand that. We appreciate that. That hasn't changed at all. And until the Constitution has changed, my belief is that all legal citizens of this country have the right to gun ownership. Simple as that. However, that being said, myself, speaking for me only, I'd certainly not resist an authorized law enforcement agent of the United States government if the powers that be should decide to come for my guns. I'll obey the laws of the land, unless the Bible tells me that the laws of the land are going directly contrary to the word of God. And I don't see that anywhere in Scripture concerning gun rights. A constitutional right? Yes, absolutely. And I, for one, hope it remains that way. A scriptural right? Show me that in the word of God. I would say to folks, if your convictions tell you that God has granted you the rights to your guns, even if gun ownership is made illegal in this country, by all means, it's entirely up to you to go hang on to your guns and let them pry your, as they say, dead fingers away from the handle. But that's entirely up to you to go with your convictions. Resist all you like. But according to Paul here, you've got to be willing to face the governmental ramifications of your decision. Telling me to go against God's word is one thing. Hopefully I'll never do that. But telling me to defy the law of the land where God's word does not dictate that I go contrary to that is something else. Believers are not called to correct all the wrongs of the sin-cursed world in which we live. We've spoken about that earlier. We're called to be ambassadors of the grace of God until such time as God calls us home. We're not going to fix the laws of the land, whether we own a gun or whether we don't. And I guarantee you, I'll find a way to protect my family, even if I don't have a gun. People don't usually like a bottle rocket launched at them either. So there's always a way to protect your family. Paul gives us clear instruction in Romans 12:18. If it be possible. Nope, wrong way there. If it be possible. Do I have that? Boy, I'm really messing this slideshow up here. Let's see what we've got here. I guess I don't have it there. If it be possible, as much as lieth in you, live peaceably with all men. So God ordained headship order. And I know you don't see that verse, but it's here somewhere. The word translated power means magistrate, potentate, authority, jurisdiction. Right now, we can thank the Lord that our Constitution, at least in the case of gun ownership, still stands. Hopefully that won't change, although it might very well change at some point in our future. With all the changes we've seen take place and with the rapid pace they've taken place, nothing would surprise me. God ordained that there be various jurisdictions of leadership or headship, where some would be in authority over others. That was his idea. Government is a God-ordained institution of headship. The part that's been left up to man is that of deciding the type of government under which they'll operate and the selection of the individuals to fill the roles of the headship positions of the government structure that's in place. For instance, God ordained marriage as a headship institution. We're all familiar with that. But God didn't choose your marriage partner. Who chose your marriage partner? You chose your marriage partner. Those who chose incorrectly are left to deal with the consequences of their decisions. It's unfortunate that many of those who agree that marriage is a divine institution, they choose a spouse, and then they marry that spouse, and they look to God for the solution when the spouse they've chosen turns out to be an improper selection. Since God designed headship order, it only stands to reason that God would have men apply the principles found in his word, rightly divided, when it comes to selecting those to fill the positions of the headship structures that are in place, especially where options are available and the selection process is presented us. The psalmist said in Proverbs 3:6, "In all thy ways acknowledge him." And there we are with the verse we just had on there. "He shall direct thy paths." the Gentiles refused to acknowledge the God they knew, according to the Apostle Paul. They cared nothing about the Most High God or His name. They served the creature more than the Creator. Paul told us in Romans 1:25 that very thing. This brought us to a new dispensation, a new set of house rules, a new economy that God would implement with this new nation of His formation, the dispensation of promise that we see in Genesis 12. It's a new way of dealing with man. So you can see how God changes the way He deals with men down through time. Now, let's return to Genesis chapter 12 for a moment, the passage where we saw the call and the covenant God made with this man named Abram. Here it is once again at the outset of the chapter. Now the Lord had said unto Abram, get thee out of thy country, from thy kindred, from thy father's house, unto a land that I will show thee. Covenant aspect number one, a land with Abram. Verse 2. And I will make of thee a great nation. There sits covenant aspect number two, a great nation. And I will bless thee and make thy name great, Abram. Covenant aspect number three, a great name. And thou shalt be a blessing. Covenant aspect number four, a channel of blessing. And we read further in verse three, and I will bless them that bless thee and curse him that curseth thee. And in thee shall all families of the earth be blessed, Abram. Now we need to understand that the greatness mentioned in this passage has nothing whatsoever to do with greatness as far as numbers are concerned. Size isn't the issue here. This has nothing to do with census figures. And it doesn't have anything to do with greatness as far as the size of the land mass that Abram is about to be shown is concerned either. The territory of Eden is not the greatest part size-wise of this planet. I think we all know that. The greatness spoken of in this passage means something else altogether, and it goes far beyond those concepts. The nation God would be forming through this man named Abram would be the nation Israel. Israel is to be great in her capacity to rule and to reign for the rightful head over the earth, the Most High God. And that will take place in time future. Israel is to be great in her capacity to function in and administer God's rightful dominion in this realm of His creation, and to represent the Most High God by making His name great throughout the earthly realm. By God's design, Israel is to be great in accordance with the role she will play in God's earthly repossession plan. And that's sitting here in this passage. All the nations of the earth are to be brought into obedience and subservience to the true monarch of the earth. And that will come through the nation Israel as God plans to bring it about. However, before that can take place, Israel will have to recognize who it is that will make her a great nation in accordance with God's plan to reclaim what belongs to Him. That's what Abram's greatness is all about in this passage. God had Israel in mind through Abram. God had a great plan in store for those who would comprise His special nation. And His special nation would come into existence through Abram and Abram's sons. Isaac's son Jacob, Jacob's sons, the 12 tribes of Israel that would form the nation Israel. So Israel will be great in connection with God's purpose for her, and it won't be through any greatness resident within her, but through God's greatness working through her and on her behalf. We'll be seeing that as we continue in our journey through the Bible. By the way, this will be a hard lesson for Israel to learn, as we're going to see. She'll have to drop any thought, any notion whatsoever of doing for God or being for God that which He needs her to do and to be, as He reclaims that which belongs to Him, namely the earthly realm. God will have to accomplish that for them, and they'll not be able to accomplish it for themselves. God's program with Israel has its roots, folks, right here in the call and the covenant God made with a man through whom that nation would come, the man named Abram. Keep in mind, this special nation will be using that God will be using in His earthly repossession plan has nothing to do with believers today. Don't read yourself into this. His plan to repossess that which rightfully belongs to Him, in this case the earthly realm, called for the establishment of a nation, singular, called Israel. And it was to that nation that God promised the territory described in Eden, as Eden in our Bible. As we saw in Genesis chapter 12, God promised that He would make of Abram a great nation, singular. So there it sits. But when we come to Genesis chapter 15, what do we find? Abraham is childless. He's still childless. So what did he do? Well, he complained to God that the only heir he had was Eliezer, the steward of his house. Had God not promised Abram earlier that He would make of him a great nation? Well, sure He had. We just read it. He made that promise to Abram back in Genesis chapter 12. How could Abram become a great nation if he was yet to have a child with Sarai and was approaching the age of 100? This is where I believe Satan instituted a brand new battle strategy in his plan of evil against God. Nothing he had tried earlier had worked to change God's mind about repossessing the earth. God told Satan in the garden, after the deception of Eve and the willful rebellion of Adam, that the seed of the woman would ultimately crush his head. Satan knew that God cannot dwell with iniquity and that God was reclaiming what rightfully belonged to him since he created it. With this new battle strategy, Satan was employing a tactic he thought might thwart God's reclamation plan. And that tactic was to prevent the continuance of the seed line. Now, none of us know what power God has granted the angelic being that's described in Scripture, or the extent of the power of that being described in Scripture as being the sum total of created wisdom and beauty. The angelic being known as Satan. The Apostle Paul tells us that the one to come, the Antichrist, will be empowered by Satan, and that he will be coming with all power and signs and lying wonders. Satan will be the power source behind those lying signs and wonders, folks. Think about the power of Satan for a moment. We know that Satan was able to deceive Eve. We know that at least some of the angelic creation had the power to take on human form, to communicate with men during time past, and that God used the non-rebellious angelic host for that very purpose. The Hebrew word translated angel simply means messenger. We know some other things about angels. We know that the angelic host can operate in a universe at speeds we can't even imagine, and that they're too numerous for us to count. God has provided us with that information in his word. We know that the rebellious angelic host had the ability to take possession of certain individuals in time past. We know that God used non-rebellious angels to bring judgment upon men in time past, and that God will use the angelic beings in time future to gather true Israel from the four corners of the earth. So that's some power, isn't it? The power that God granted to angelic beings in time past was tremendous in scope. In the book of 2 Samuel, for instance, we'll just mention this, we have a minute left, we read about King David numbering the people of Israel. This was not a census that God had ordered David to make, but it was an attempt by David to see how many men he could gather up to go to battle in Israel to accomplish David's conquest, the conquest he had in mind. Does God need a lot of men when it comes to conquest by way of his hand? No, it was always a few. Was David taking his eyes off of God? Rather than trusting in God's ability, no matter the numbers, David was glorying in what he reasoned to be Israel's ability, number-wise, rather than God's capacity. God judged David at that time. Actually, he used an angel to deliver that judgment. And that angel slew 70,000 men that very day. Is that power? That sound like great power to you? When that angel stretched out his hand to destroy Jerusalem, God halted his hand, the Bible says, by saying, "It is enough. Stay now thy hand." You can read about that in 2 Samuel chapter 24. The question is, did Satan have anything to do with the barrenness of Abraham's wife, Sarai? Sarah. Abraham and Sarah now. Could we be seeing satanic battle strategy number four? The battle tactic I call intervention through the avenue of non-production taking place here. As Abram goes to God and said, "You've promised me to be a great nation, but look here. Nobody but Eleazar do I have to be an heir." So we'll stop there today. We'll pick it up here when we return in our next study. And we'll continue to look at the power resident in the angelic realm. And we'll watch God continue his lesson to man according to teaching us who he is and who man is not. And of man's great need for God to put all the aspects of his name into play for them and do so graciously.